Why do people like pixel art in video games? I'm not disparaging it, I think it looks great, personally, but why? Maybe it's just because of the way that it looks, or maybe it's because the nostalgic feeling is comforting for people that remember that era. I know I get that feeling from the art style that the original Diablo and Fallout games had. It reminds me of a time before the waking nightmare of modern life. Do you remember when you had to hold a landline phone against your ear with your shoulder while you played computer games? Back when phones were just for calling your friends and not for reading about the secret society performing ritualistic child sacrifice on a private island? Things were so simple back then. You see, before computer games started pigging out on dimensions and greedily decided that two just wasn't enough, there was a special moment when we had 3D graphics, but everyone was too poor to render them in real time. So, game developers created 3D models and then took tiny pictures of them and assembled those into sprite sheets. This way, the children of divorced dads could still install cereal box CD game demos onto their giant combination monitor Macintosh computers. With that spirit in mind, I created my own game, and you've been tricked somehow into watching a devlog about it. This time around, I added races. Beautiful, precious races. Each one is just as valuable as the last, unless you measure that by their base stats, in which case one is clearly better. I rigged this goblino, which is Italian for goblin, and hammered out the necessary animations. Attacking, running, idling, combat idle, drawing a weapon, getting hit, strafing, walking, and God forbid we ever have to use it, dying. Before we take these suckers for a test run, though, I'm going to yammer a bit about the technicals. If it wasn't obvious, I've done a similar thing to those developers from the era that I love. But since sprite sheets alone wasn't annoying enough to work with, I made things extra difficult on myself by splitting each character into a series of sprite sheets to represent each limb, so the character can still be animated with one of them missing. The results I love, but the workload I do not. Anyways, there I was attempting to add a second mob to my game, these goblins, rendered beautifully in the style I just described to you, which meant recreating all the animations the human was capable of, like walking, drawing a weapon, strafing, running, attacking. Quite a lot of work for someone that doesn't enjoy animation and isn't very good at it. I'd finished up the first pass and went to put them in the game, and the problem was, sometimes the 3D animation doesn't translate well to 2D, and you end up with a combat walk that looks like this. Mother of God, that is ugly. After all that effort, there I was with this dog shit animation I wouldn't dare to leave in the game, even if it's just a first pass. That's when I realized what a headache the pipeline I'd been using to turn 3D models into sprites was becoming. Even with a script generating sprite sheets for every limb, direction, and frame, I still had to modify the script every time I went to add an item or animation. Then, once they were generated, I had to drag them into Unity, modify some fields to import the images properly, create assets, fill the fields in on those assets with all the sprite sheets, and then add those assets to another asset that contained them all before I could use them in the game. I automated several steps in the process with Unity editor scripts, but they still have to be triggered in sequential order and usually need additional effort to complete. To top it all off, my Blender file was now a bloated mess, and continuing to push out assets with it was just going to keep getting worse. All the animations had to take place on a single timeline with a hard-coded value written into the script for the start and end frame, as well as all the animations that I wanted to render at any given time. Since I was now working with a brand new character, it was my chance to refine the process into something more practical, so it doesn't take me as long to iterate. I changed the script into a full Blender add-on, which lets me manipulate the data with UI components instead of modifying different scripts. Then I changed the system to use actions instead of a single timeline, and this keeps things cleaner, but also means I can get the length of the animation through code instead of manually entering values. It also means animations between objects don't need to be synced, so I can do things like change the action on the right hand to have items either on the character's back or in their hands without having to create a brand new animation. Now I can just select the animations I want to render in the add-on's UI, hit a button, and generate them. This was a big step for the future of the project. Anyways, with that done, it was now practical to make a modification to the animations, so it was time to get a first pass on all of them complete and put into the game. The results was pretty heartwarming. Something about seeing another creature in the world just tickles me pink. And with the add-on taking the majority of the effort here, adding additional characters in the future will be much faster. Since the game is a simulation, it's important that anything the player is capable of doing, the non-player characters are as well. The code was written with this in mind, so now that separate races exist within the code base, it's trivial to swap out any humanoid entity with a different race. That means the player can be a goblin. Try walking a mile in their stupid f***ing shoes. I like the way this felt when I tried it out, so I think I'm going to include race as part of the character generation. I think a random chance to do a playthrough as some f***ed up freak is a fun way to add a little variety to the game. It's important for me to get the look and feel of the characters right, so don't think this is the final version of anything, but rather a step in the process. Starting over from scratch with the goblins also gave me a chance to rethink where the limbs separate from each other. The human I made a very long time ago didn't have a lot of thought put into it. I just sliced the characters up and went on my merry way because I hadn't even written the script to generate the sprite sheets at the time. I had no idea how anything was going to end up, and with the power of hindsight, I've adjusted the location of the splits so individual leg armor pieces hopefully won't create this look of assless chaps like it does with the humans. And now, body armor could be responsible for shoulder pads, which, and I'm no blacksmith or anything, feels more in line with real armor. The downside of all this effort is that I'll have to go back to the drawing board a bit with the human characters and recreate a lot of the work I did when I was just figuring this all out. I mean, this human was the first 3D model I ever made. I've learned so much about the art side of things that starting him over was going to be necessary at some point anyways. And, since I'm actually using normal maps to generate detail, it's feasible that my new models could be rendered 3D in-engine in case that's ever necessary in the future. It's also more in line with how video game artists actually make content in Blender, which means it would be easier for me to put another person's work into my game. And I did that to get out of the mindset of prototyping. Considering the future state and doing things right the first time instead of trying to prove a concept was even possible like I was a year ago. Because when it comes down to it, I really want to make this f***ing game. So let's get stoked, because I'm burning for it now, folks. Anyways, that's it for now. Next time we're going to take another look at the AI and hopefully tack an ism onto our new race. Peace out, everybody.